Hello, and welcome back to Western Water Weekly, where we break down the stories we reported from across the Colorado River Basin and beyond. This week, we're covering everything from new federal funding proposals and state-level water strategies to troubling drought forecasts, data breakthroughs, and legal shakeups in tribal water rights. Let's dive in. We start this week with the 2026 River Budget Proposal released by the nonprofit American Rivers. Their message to Congress? Invest now, because the country's water infrastructure is in dire need of repair. The group is urging lawmakers to allocate nearly $9.3 billion across two major programs that fund clean and safe drinking water systems. These systems are aging, underfunded, and in many areas, dangerously outdated. But it's not just about pipes and treatment plants. $2 billion for flood-resilient infrastructure, funding for wetland restoration and native vegetation, new support for tribal access and low-income water assistance, and over $8 billion for rural and agricultural programs like watershed protection and irrigation efficiency. The recommendations are just that. Recommendations. But American Rivers hopes they'll guide the federal budget process and help communities prepare for a future defined by extreme weather, water stress, and ecosystem decline. In California, Governor Gavin Newsom announced a sweeping update to the Bay Delta Water Quality Control Plan, the first major revision since 1995. This new approach blends habitat restoration with water reliability through the Healthy Rivers and Landscapes Program, a voluntary system where water users can choose to contribute environmental flows and help restore 45,000 acres of aquatic habitat. It's a science-informed plan backed by $2.9 billion in funding, and it's paired with proposed legislation to streamline approvals by loosening certain procedural hurdles in California's environmental review process. If successful, the plan could usher in a new era of cooperation between cities, farms, tribes, and ecosystems. New federal forecasts show that Lake Mead, already strained, may hit its lowest level ever by 2027. If that happens, we could see record cuts to water use in Arizona and Nevada. Even in the best-case scenario, the reservoir's elevation will likely fall below the threshold that triggers Tier 2 shortages by July of next year. And if conditions worsen, we could be looking at a Tier 3 emergency, one step away from crisis. Southern Nevada has managed to cut water use by over one-third in the past two decades and says it's prepared. But experts are warning, we need more conservation, more flexibility, and a serious plan because time is running out. For those looking to understand water conditions more clearly, the Geoconics Explorer is a game changer. This map-based platform, developed by the United States Geological Survey, lets users search for any river or stream and instantly access data from multiple agencies, including streamflow, water quality, and reservoir levels. It's part of a broader push for open water data and public transparency, and it could become an essential tool for researchers, managers, and everyday citizens alike. You can check it out yourself at explorer.geoconics.us. On Tuesday, a magnitude 8.8 earthquake off the coast of eastern Russia triggered a tsunami watch along the California coast. Although no major impacts were reported, this event served as a reminder that coastal water management and emergency preparedness go hand in hand. Artificial intelligence may be digital, but its infrastructure is physical and thirsty. A new report by Western Resource Advocates warns that data centers across the western U.S. could consume over 21,000 acre-feet of water annually by 2035. Enough to serve nearly 200,000 people for a year. Electricity demand is also projected to spike by more than 50%, putting strain on grids and emissions targets. The group is calling for stronger regulations, public reporting of water use, and incentives for water-efficient technologies. They argue that if data centers want tax breaks, they should offer real community benefits and commit to renewable power. Senator Ben Ray Lujan is sounding the alarm over funding shortfalls in the Navajo Gallup Water Supply Project, a pipeline that's been in the works for decades and is meant to deliver clean water to 250,000 Navajo residents. With costs ballooning and Gallup's groundwater running dangerously low, the city is now facing unthinkable scenarios, from lawsuits to bankruptcy, if federal funds are not secured. Lujan is pushing for $175 million this fiscal year, warning that without it, the project could become the first tribal water rights settlement to collapse. A major court ruling in the Gila River Indian Community versus Scobroke case could reshape how subflow disputes are handled in Arizona. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled that the case must go to trial, not be decided in advance, because it's unclear whether the landowner's wells are tapping into protected river water known as subflow. The court also clarified that neither the 1935 Globe Equity Decree nor state adjudication proceedings hold exclusive power over these disputes. For tribal nations, this means federal courts remain open for defending water rights, but proving those violations will require clear and convincing evidence. California is fighting back against land subsidence, the gradual sinking of ground caused by overpumping groundwater. A new draft guidance document outlines best practices for water agencies to monitor and reduce subsidence, especially in the San Joaquin Valley, where infrastructure like canals, levees, and roads has been damaged. Major repair investments are already underway, including nearly $2.4 billion for key canal systems. Public comments on the guidance document are open through September 22nd, and meetings will be held in Delano, Clovis, and Willows. And finally, let's check in with the latest U.S. drought monitor. There was good news in the Midwest, where rainfall eased drought in places like Kansas and Minnesota. But across the West, not so lucky. Dry conditions worsened in Colorado, Utah, and Wyoming, while surface water supplies in Arizona remain low. California's reservoirs are still above average, but forecasts predict hot and dry weather that could change that quickly. Meanwhile, Lake Mead and Lake Powell remain stubbornly low, both hovering around 31 to 32% of total capacity, a stark reminder that the Colorado River system is still under enormous pressure. That wraps up this week's episode of Western Water Weekly. Be sure to visit westernwater.com for daily updates and full coverage on the stories we've discussed. Thanks for watching, and stay hydrated.